his time. So welcome, Nandan. It is a privilege and a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you, Sanjay. I'm looking forward to this session.
You have seen the power of platforms from multiple dimensions. Aadhaar, when you were with the government, reimagining identification as a unique identification as a dimension for India, then UPI, the Unified Payments Interface, and the entire India Stack conversation, and then of course Ekstay Foundation, Diksha, what we are seeing now as a tremendous velocity with education. What have been some of the summary experiences that you would like to warm up today's conversation with?
Yeah, so I think, you know, my first experience of really large scale work was when I joined the government in 2009. I mean, at Infosys, we had done things at scale, but that scale, when you talk about an entire population, is a different thing altogether. And I was quite nervous about the whole idea of how would I actually be able to figure out a way to give 1.3 billion people a digital ID. And so when I took up the challenge, I had many transitions. I moved from the private sector to the government. I moved from Bangalore to Delhi. And I moved from sitting in a corner office overlooking a golf course to running a government startup, which is, you know, is about as crazy as it can get. A government startup is even more difficult than a regular startup because, you know, nobody gives it the time of the day. And so it was a difficult thing. But what I found, one was that people are attracted to bold and audacious goals. You know, I was able to assemble a terrific team of people for this project. And it was a very curious mix because on the one hand, I had a set of people who were from the government, from the bureaucracy, who had worked in the system for 25, 30 years, dyed-in-the-wool bureaucrats. But in some sense, all of them were mavericks because, you know, they had been in the system, but they wanted to do something big and bold. And so they were like self-selecting themselves for this project, which I realized later that this was not the project for somebody who is risk averse. This is actually meant for people who want to take a risk. And at the same time, I was able to assemble a set of people from the private sector, from the technology world, people who had worked in Silicon Valley, who also wanted to do something and contribute back. And these were two different worlds, the world of bureaucrats and the world of, you know, tech startup guys. And a lot of my job was actually to bring these two worlds together and make sure that they didn't, you know, that they worked well together. And it took some time to get there. So I think having a terrific bunch of people is a huge requirement. And, you know, nowadays, whenever I look at doing anything, I only do it when I feel that I have the people in place to pull it off. That to me is very important. And the second thing is that thinking scale unlocks your mind because, you know, we had to think about how to reach a billion people. And I was very clear that we would do it within the term of one government because in politics, when governments change, priorities change. And I knew that there was a 5-year window in which we had to get this to a scale which would then carry on its own momentum. So we had an ambitious plan to reach 600 million people in 5 years, which means, and we needed about, you know, we needed about 14 months to even build what we had to build. And so we had to build something which delivered, you know, 1.5 million people a day to be enrolled. So a lot of thinking was, how do you really create something where you can scale it up to that level? And we did that by standardizing the front-end enrollment so that there was a standard client, but you could add any number of enrollment clients. So, you know, the idea is that you don't create dependencies on each other. Everything is like uncoupled. And at the back end, we created an infrastructure using technology, which could do 1.5 million biometric duplications a day. So at the back end, it was a technology problem. At the front end, it was more an organizational problem. But the biggest challenge, frankly, was neither the technology nor the approach. It was convincing people to do this. And, you know, I didn't have a law behind me. I was part of the planning commission, which is not really seen as an execution arm of the government. And, you know, government, everybody is very conscious about their own turf. And, you know, the more, if I did something which was intruding on somebody's turf, then, you know, they would react pretty strongly. So I had to find a way to navigate through all that. And since the technology was taking 14 months, I decided to spend that time in evangelizing what we were doing. So I went around the country and visited every state and met the chief minister and the bureaucrats and told them what's coming and made them partners on this journey. So when the thing actually came, they were not surprised. So that's a lot of my effort was really in building a consensus to get everybody on board and keeping the design simple so that we didn't tread on many toes. So I think there are many, many lessons, Sanjay, from that. And then I was able to parlay that experience into what we did on the payments platform, which was slightly different because that was done by NPCI. And there it was a mix of you know, technology and market making and working with regulators. So I think for me, these have all been very interesting lessons. And, you know, I think it's always, you know, you always become nervous when you start on one of these journeys. But I think if you don't deter and keep at it day in and day out, something is bound to happen in a few years. So that's how I think about it.
Thanks, Nandan. And I remember in way back in July of 2016, you had very lucidly articulated the possibility of abstracting this learning. And the potential of, you had this vision that something like this could be converted into a reusable, reconstructable piece of knowledge. And that is how you and along with Rohini's ideas, this whole idea of societal platform, which is what around the entire Aspire is woven around. And that time you spoke about speed, scale, and sustainability as the three fundamental objectives. So would love to hear that. How did you get to that abstraction? Because you were seeing different patterns, Aadhaar, UPI, Xtep was starting to form up. So you were able to abstract a pattern. How did you come to this sense that there is something here that this can be used for replication?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I think pattern recognition when you do multiple things is very important. And clearly, the speed thing in Aadhaar came because I had a very simple challenge, which was how do I make sure that this reaches a scale and speed which will continue it even when I'm not there? Because, you know, especially when you work in the government, you have narrow windows of opportunity because, you know, governments change, politicians change, bureaucrats change, priorities change. You know, if you have 10 meetings in a day, each meeting is about a different topic. So, you know, it's like you have attention deficit disorder at scale going on. And therefore, in that system, to stick to something and get it done is very important. And I realized that if I had to make this outlast my presence in the system, it had to reach a certain size and maturity and impact which nobody could sort of unravel. So speed and scale became very important for purely from the tactical idea that we should reach a point of, you know, it goes on without me. So that was part of it. And then, and that's why the sustainability comes in, which is the true test of these things is, will it last without you? And I think to me, that's a very important criteria, because I generally would like to walk away from something when it reaches maturity, when it's a fully grown up thing and other people can look after it. So for me, that's very important. So sustainability was also important. And I learned all the three in Aadhaar, and then we applied the same principles in UPI. But the other thing we learned also was that, you know, you can build infrastructure at scale, but when it interfaces with people, then you need to have enormous variety and diversity. And we learned that in UPI by ensuring that while the backend platform was highly scalable, the frontend app could come from the government, like a Beam app, or it could come from a Google or a WhatsApp or a PhonePe or whatever. And then, so the idea that you have something which at the back, which is fully scalable, but at the front can take on different avatars I think that's very important. And some of this then came into our educational platform thinking. So, you know, as you do these things, you sort of see some patterns emerging, and then you try to extract a set of rules from that, and then you try to put those together. And that's how, Sanjay, when you know you came on board in 2016, we sort of zeroed in on this idea that maybe we can take all this and it's applicable to many other things. Now, obviously, it's not applicable to all issues. I mean, you know, societies are very complex. But where there is something which has to be delivered at scale, where there's something which requires uniform quality of distribution, where you need diversity in its different aspects, at the same time, there are elements of it which are scalable, where technology can be an enabler. And there are many, many examples of that. You can do that in education, you can do that in financial inclusion, you can do that in livelihoods, you can do that in health. So there are many, many large societal issues where I think this thinking applies. So that's how, you know, now it's 4 years that we have worked together to put this into a body of knowledge. And we hope that, you know, the folks on this call who are all amazing leaders, who are all doing great societal changing things, if some of these lessons are even useful, that's our contribution.
Thank you so much, Nandan. And the term that you have used often is the role that digital plays in orchestration. You use this word, digital orchestration platforms, right? And that's the underlying. Initially, if you recall, we used to use a word called digital spine, and then we moved to digital infrastructure. And so the idea that digital is not about the next app or the next portal, but digital is actually a fundamental foundational backbone. We would love to hear your perspectives on this, because the leaders on this call obviously are now thinking through what kind of a backbone, what kind of an infrastructure do they need to imagine, rather than how do I build the next app or the next website. And I think that's where your experience with digital from multiple dimensions, bringing up Infosys obviously was one experience, and then of course Aadhaar and the other platforms. So what is it that you think we should learn from your experiences?
Well, you know, I've come to the conclusion that it's not about specific apps or solutions, because specific apps and solutions depend on the context, depend on the time, and they can change. It's more about having a sort of agile and well-designed infrastructure which can morph itself to new demands and new things. And that applies equally well to businesses. In fact, for the last 3 years, as you know, I've been back at Infosys as the chairman. And all my time is really spent on how to make that organization more agile and more responsive. I don't really specifically care whether this is the customer or that is the use case. It's how do you make that organization agile and responsive, and how do you use technology to get there? That's been my focus. So I think digital orchestration is really, how do you think about putting in that capability? It's about retaining optionality. It's about retaining degrees of freedom in making sure that different things are possible, and not specifically get into saying this is the solution or that is the solution. Because to me, those solutions are best designed and implemented by those people who are closest to the beneficiary or to the society or to the community. And I don't think we should second guess that. Rather, how do we enable them to be more effective, do it faster, give them more flexibility? So that's broadly where I've been. My thinking has been across the work, both I do in the public and the private space.
One follow-through question on that, Nandan, that has been coming from the cohort here as well, has been, obviously you have very deep-rooted experience both in government and in the private sector. But when you look at societal platform thinking in the context of the civil society actors, the Samaj players, right, who are the on the call as well, people who are actually working with missions, what would be your perspective or advice for them? Because they are now looking at morphing themselves into becoming infrastructure-led scale play. What would you think?
Well, I think, See, the drivers are different. In government, you know, it's about getting the attention of the system to your what you're doing. In other words, because as I said, government juggles many, many priorities. And therefore, a big part of the job is to get the resources, the budgets, the attention, the signaling that you need to say that this is important to the system. And so that's, you know, and that's how you actually make things work, apart from, of course, navigating through all the complexities of characters and interests. In markets, I think it's about really creating things that meet customer needs and solve customers' issues, give them conveniences, and so on. Whereas when you talk about societies and communities, it's a very different situation where you need to get the, you know, you need to have something which is compelling enough for them to need. It's not a market thing. It's about them, you know, improving some aspect of their life. And, you know, my experience of that is more in the recent years, because at Infosys, it was really about running the, you know, company in the market space. At Aadhaar was really about government. And even UPI was working with a nonprofit like technology nonprofit like NPCI and partnering with other tech companies. But I think the big experience in the community-led thinking is really now in what we're doing in Ekstep and Diksha, because there everybody's involved: schools, children, parents, teachers, tutors, you name it. And how do you while you orchestrate it all together, how do you make sure there's enough in it for them to take it and move forward? So I think each has this, but finally it's about finding that magic key in each space, which creates that pull and demand and momentum. And you know, it takes time, it takes years. I mean, in our Ekstep journey, we did a lot of things before we finally honed in on how to get it to, you know, ramp up. So sometimes these things take time, but I do believe that if you think hard enough and long enough and work with enough people, you can finally get to that magic key which creates scale in whatever you're doing.
Thanks, Nandan. One last question before I turn over to the Ashoka team. You have always shared with us that do, think, do is a better process than think, do, think, which is take action, think, move forward. And we know that now you are not sort of resting on the stuff, but you're already in the process of thinking through and building the next infrastructure that can deal with the biggest challenge that we have at hand, which is COVID. And I know that you're spending a substantial amount of your time thinking through vaccination, building the impact aperture, creating the consensus, building the more. Share with us some of the lessons or some of the perspectives that you're gaining from this experience around the vaccination related thought processes that you have started firming up, because that is the need of the hour for the entire world.
Yes, I think that, I was attracted to this issue because it has all the elements that we talked about. It's about scale. How do we give 7 billion people a vaccination? And if it means, you know, many of the vaccines are double dose, that means 14 million injections or whatever. It's about speed, because every day that we are able to do it faster, we can bring our global society back to some kind of normalcy. And it's about doing it in a way that, you know, is safe and so on. So it has all the elements of what we talked about. So I've, you know, there are four parts to this. One is, of course, the vaccine themselves. And, you know, people tend to focus on the vaccines. My own thought is that the vaccines will come. And that has been my thought for the last 6 months. And the last 3 weeks have proved that, because we have the Pfizer vaccine, we have the Moderna vaccine, and now we have the AstraZeneca vaccine. And I'm convinced that in the next 6 to 8 months, there will be many more vaccines. All of them will be pretty effective. Now, therefore, we are going to have a period of vaccine shortage in the beginning, when you have to allocate the vaccines to vulnerable people, frontline workers, and so on. And then you're going to have a point where there'll be enough vaccines. And finally, 6 months to 9 months from now, you're going to have vaccine surplus, because vaccines is an industrial process, whereas delivery is a handcrafted process. And inevitably, the industrial will overwhelm the delivery. For example, if a new vaccine comes in June of next year, which has a manufacturing capacity of, you know, 500 million vaccines a year, suddenly there's going to flood the market. So I think not enough attention has been focused on the front end is how do we deliver in India, for example, how do you deliver 10 million vaccinations a day? And that requires 200,000 vaccinators. And that requires, you know, so I've been paying attention more to the front end delivery aspect. And that's where the Aadhaar experience was useful, because there we built a system to enroll 1.5 million people a day. Here we have to build a system to vaccinate 10 million people a day. So that's been my thinking. And the other thing is the flexibility and agility, because we want to scale, but we don't know which vaccines will work. You know, vaccine that is approved today may get rejected tomorrow because at scale it has unacceptable side effects. So your architecture has to be agile to bring in a new vaccine and, you know, put a old vaccine out. And so the agility is also important. And then there's the whole issue of capacity building of, 200,000 vaccinators in India alone. Around the world, you may need 1 million vaccinators or more. And then finally, there's the whole issue of how do we ensure that the world knows that you are vaccinated? Because unless we have an interoperable vaccination certificate, how do we start traveling? If I take a plane, how do I know the guy will let me board the plane? Because he'll want to see my vaccination certificate. If I want to go and get to a restaurant, how will he allow me inside? So we need to have a digital vaccination certificate, which is verifiable as proof of vaccination. So, and how do you do that for 7 billion people? So, I mean, these are all issues that I'm grappling with. Not that anybody is listening to me. I mean, I think you're giving the impression that people are waiting with, you know, bated breath. Nobody's actually asking me about this, but I thought, let me figure it out. Maybe someday somebody will come and say, why can you help us fix this? So that's where I am now, Sanjay.
Thank you so much, Nandan. It's always so fascinating to get perspectives from you.